Hello, class. Welcome to the course, Phil 136, The Philosophy of Art. My name is Matthias Warnes, and I'll be your instructor. First off, what is the philosophy of art? Well, it's not art history. So if your desire in signing up for this course was to get a survey of the history of Western or of global art, that won't be happening here. We will cover some prominent art forms in the history of Western art, and a few paintings, poems, sculptures, and musical compositions here and there. But the focus of this course is on what philosophers have to say about art, what it is and why it is important for our view of the world, whether that view is articulated in terms of an ontology, a theory of being, a metaphysics, a theory of reality, what is, an ethics, or, of course, an aesthetics. What exactly does aesthetics mean, and what is the connection between aesthetics and the philosophy of art? How did the discipline of philosophical aesthetics within philosophy get going? How did it develop, and why is it important? And most importantly, what is art? And its related concepts of aesthetic experience, such as the beautiful, the sublime, as well as its relationship to the ethical, the good. In this introductory lecture, we'll be surveying the field known as philosophy of art or aesthetics to give you a better sense of what this course will be about. A good place to start, epigraphs for the course, you could say, we can find in Goethe, in his Maxims and Reflections. We sometimes see art as a flight from reality and into fantasy. And Goethe remarks, "There is no way of more surely avoiding the world than by art, and it is by art that you form the surest link with it." Goethe here highlighting the paradox of the nature of art, at once a child of fancy, and at the same time, the recreation of reality and world itself. Goethe points to the effective character of art, how it fulfills the emotional or feeling aspects of our nature, when he notes that even at the moment of highest bliss and of highest distress, we need the artist. Art can send us into spasms of ecstasy, as well can act as a therapeutic balm to life's troubles. The artist is clearly important in the economy of life. We often find works of art to be beautiful, and yet when we are asked what beauty is, we become perplexed and are unsure how to answer. According to Goethe, beauty can never be clear about itself. We might seek for an essential concept or idea of beauty, which we can see instantiated in the many instances of beautiful things. And this is part of the work of the understanding we do when we undertake to do philosophy of art. But what beauty itself is far from clear. In this course, we'll see various definitions of beauty from across the history of Western philosophy, but in the end, we may have to still agree with Goethe. Beauty is somehow mysterious, that is extra-logical or pre-rational, and that the attempt to clearly define what it is leads us only into perplexities and obscurities. For like the nature that ever conceals its mysteries from our grasp, beauty can never be clear about itself. And one last epigraph to start off our course, anyone who now intends to write or argue about art ought to have some idea of what philosophy has achieved and continues to achieve in our day. Taking Goethe's four maxims on art together, we find, as in Russian dolls, paradoxes within paradoxes. On the one hand, art is the flight of fancy and the recreation of the world, the exaltation of our highest bliss and happiness, and the soothing of our deepest distress, manifestation of the beauty of the human soul or spirit, or the representation of natural beauty, a radiant and scintillating sight, and yet one that remains wrapped in obscurities and enigmas. And lastly, the injunction that philosophy might somehow be able to help us engage with, write, or argue about art, even if art and philosophy are completely different types of cognitive and spiritual activity. Back to our main question, what is art? What is aesthetics? Before going into the question, what is art? Let's first ask, what is aesthetics? And here we find a few helpful historical fixed points which can help to orient our discussion. For example, the term aesthetics was coined only in the 18th century by the German philosopher Alexander Baumgarten. As a noun, aesthetics is a set of principles concerned with the nature and appreciation of beauty and the sublime, especially in art and in nature. Its second dictionary definition is the branch of philosophy that deals with the principles of artistic taste. The word aesthetics comes from the Greek word aesthetike, which can mean sensation or perception. So the term itself goes back a very far way, but it doesn't become a discipline or field within philosophy until the 18th century, from which point we can find both rationalist and empiricist theories of aesthetics and the beginnings of the discipline of modern aesthetics. More on that soon. In Ribeiro's Introduction to Aesthetics, which I've provided in the course pack, he as well points out that the term has its roots in sense perception, Greek aesthesis, which might make us think that a course in philosophy of art or aesthetics will be concerned with the science of perception in general. However, the ancient Greek understanding of aesthesis and the modern aesthetics are very different. The word itself emigrates to distant countries and comes to acquire new meanings in new home languages. Although aesthetics still retains its root connection to sense perception, it came to mean more the study of our perception of the beautiful, both in nature and in works of art. Again, Baumgarten in 1735 baptizes unwittingly what was to become a new emerging discipline within philosophy. The story of the philosophy of art or aesthetics, however, doesn't begin simply with Baumgarten. The theoretical study of the beautiful and of art indeed has a far deeper and richer history than this fairly recent label. A history that goes all the way back to the culture that gave rise to its name and the first philosophers to discuss the arts, who were Plato and Aristotle. As Ribeiro writes, it is fair to say that the history of aesthetics is, as Alfred North Whitehead said of the history of philosophy as a whole, a series of footnotes to Plato. For it was Plato who first sets the topics and terms of the debate, and every philosopher after him either followed or reacted against the views he first set forth, any innovations occurring within the framework that Plato established. This general statement on the history of philosophy is true also of the subdiscipline in philosophy aesthetics. And here we note, the history of philosophy of art in particular, the area of aesthetics concerned with art forms and works, is largely the history of the philosophy of a very specific form of art, that is poetry. And this not in the sense that we generally think of poetry today, that is as lyric poetry, but in the broader sense of an art that included composition and creative performance, epics, dramatic plays, and the lyric poem, often accompanied by music and dance. This multi-genre performance art, which the Greeks simply understood under the term Mousike, is that privileged art form to which philosophers devoted the bulk of their attention when doing philosophy of art or aesthetics for the past 2,500 years. Only in the past several hundred years has philosophy given a focused attention on other arts like sculpture or architecture, etc. Since the 18th century, philosophical studies of the fine arts tends to divide itself along the lines of poetics, painting, sculpture, architecture, music, rhetoric, dance, theater, opera, literature, etc. But there have also been extensive philosophical writings on art forms that exceed or precede these customary genres for the arts, such as the arts of gardening, engraving, decorative arts, or even any fine craft or skill being considered as an art, such as medicine or philosophy. Since the discourse of aesthetics or philosophy of art for the West moves from ancient Greece through European philosophy and German or French philosophy in particular, we need to learn a few foreign words in order to translate ourselves back into how art and aesthetics were understood. The German word for art is Kunst, similar in meaning to the ancient Greek word techne, from which we get technology and technics, as well as technique. Any craft could be understood as techne or Kunst. But in discussing the fine arts, whether in terms of their roots in performance art or musike, or in the more specific genres of the later categorization of the fine arts, the Greeks often used another word as well, poesis, which means making in the broadest sense. The Latin term from which we get the word art is ars. Whether we're speaking of the German Kunst, the Greek techne or poesis, or the Latin ars, we're concerned in all instances with making. Whereas now we speak of the many arts, the ancient Greeks spoke of the many muses. And when we study art or aesthetics in philosophy class, we're speaking not just of the fine arts, but also of the many crafts. That is, we're undertaking an inquiry into the nature of artistic creativity, of artistic making, poesis in general. Most everything in the field of modern and contemporary aesthetics or philosophy of art is highly contested, beginning with the very terms of the difference between ancient and modern aesthetics. In a seminal 1951 paper, The Modern System of the Arts, Paul Kristeller famously argued that the modern system of arts did not emerge until the mid-18th century in the works of the aesthetician Charles Batteau. And on this view, our modern conception of the fine arts had no parallel in the ancient world or in the Middle Ages. This is often taken as an established view in introductory survey courses to aesthetics or the philosophy of art. However, more recently, James Young, in his article, The Ancient and Modern System of the Arts, argues that Kristeller was wrong, and that Batteau's division of the fine arts, far from being something novel, is taken over wholesale from the ancient conception of the imitative arts as a whole. The ancients as well defined what we would call the fine arts in terms of fundamental divisions between poetry, painting, music, sculpture, and dance, where these would often overlap in the complete work of art, such as, for example, the ritual performance in a finely decorated temple or theater. According to Young, writers from the 16th century on adopted the ancient conception of the imitative arts and anticipated the views of Batteau by some 200 years. Batteau's only innovation is to popularize the rubric, the fine arts. In our own textbook, Tanke and McQuillan approach ancient aesthetics in terms of an observation by E.H. Gombrich of that great awakening when art flourished in ancient Greece. For these Greeks, it was art that mattered, not philosophical aesthetics. When we find the word aesthetics in ancient Greek philosophical texts, the word is not used in reference to works of art or beauty, but refers simply to sense perception, which is often contrasted with thought, knowledge, or reason. And thus we find philosophers like Heraclitus or Parmenides denouncing aesthesis for being mutable, illusory, and a poor guide to wisdom. The history of aesthetics or philosophy of art is in many ways the history of a transformation in the meaning of distinctive Greek terms. The four most important being beauty, Greek kalon, pleasure, hedone, art, techne or kunst, imitation, the Greek mimesis or representation. Ribeiro observes that because the beautiful or fine, to kalon in Greek, was originally understood not only as a good, something of value in our lives, but also as the good, something we ought to aspire to, a moral or intellectual ideal. And accordingly, debate about the beautiful in the ancient Greek world was not in the first instance an aesthetic debate, but was first and foremost concerned with ethical, epistemological, and even metaphysical or ontological doctrines. For the Greeks, aesthetic experience and aesthetic properties were considered objective and universal, tending to imitate nature and providing its ideal models or forms. It is only when we begin to think of the artist not as representing something external to him, such as nature, but as expressing something within himself, such as his thoughts, emotions, and ideas, that we get what Ribeiro calls the subjective turn in aesthetics, with its idea that the criterion for the evaluation of art or the judgment this is beautiful gradually becomes a subjective matter as well. And at this point in modern aesthetics, another notion emerges and becomes dominant in philosophy of art, that is the notion of taste, i.e. good taste versus bad taste, and who are the qualified judges of aesthetic taste. Ribeiro notes how the ancient words for art primarily signify craft or skill, which already indicates how the artists or artisans were regarded. They were demiurgos, literally those who work, urgos, for the people, the demos. They might be paid to write verses for the epitaph of a nobleman or to sculpt bas-reliefs for the tomb of a tradesman. Demiurgoi might be summoned to set mosaics for a living room or paint frescoes on its walls. Or they might be commissioned to create statues depicting gods and myths, or realistic representations, or the busts of wealthy politicians and other notable personalities as a means to honor and remember them, much as we might have photos of our grandparents in our living rooms today. Demiurgoi might be valued highly, but not too highly. They're skilled crafts generally involving a lot of hard work generally being shunned by well-to-do Greek citizens who could hire someone else to do it and had many slaves. Alongside the demiurgoi who produced physical objects of a high degree of technical craftsmanship or skill, poetry as well was understood as a techne. And poets had a separate and higher standing than painters or sculptors, in part because they performed serious roles as moral, religious, and historical guides, and in part because their ability to use words well and to read and to write was the privilege of a minority, and importantly did not involve manual labor, something openly scorned by those who could afford not to live by it. In general, in the ancient Greek and Roman worlds, poetry and the attendant arts of music and dance were treated with higher regard than architecture, sculpture, or painting. These latter were skills that anyone could learn and put in the service of those who could pay for them. But poetry or musique required the added boon of inspiration seen as a gift from the gods themselves. In any case, all of these and many others were artes or technai, and the artist, usually anonymous, except for notable poets, or the very highest creators of sculpture, such as Phidias, were traders of their skill. Indeed, nearly all of them, with some notable exceptions, were men, since the public realm of trade and study was eminently a male one, while women's province was the private world of the home. We'll see some notable exceptions to this in our course, such as Sappho of the island of Lesbos, or Aspasia, the influential courtesan and partner of Pericles, and likely the teacher of Socrates' views on love in the Symposium. One of the biggest distinctions subtending the entire history of the philosophy of art is that of nature versus art. Is the task of art to imitate or to transcend nature? Does art fall under the inspirational powers of a deeper or higher nature? Is nature originally artful? Or should we shore up the strict distinction between the products of nature and the products of human skill or craft, seeing them as distinct levels of reality? The word nature in ancient Greek is phusis, and in Latin natura, from which we get our modern English nature. And it tends to mean the realm of all growing things, that is, of things which appear and disappear in the seasons of time. By the time of Aristotle and subsequently, nature came to be understood as the realm of beings as such as a whole. That is, minus the technai onta, merely fabricated beings, which Aristotle explains in his Physics, Book B1. It was philosophy, specifically the philosophy after Plato, starting with Aristotle, that established stricter distinctions between the realm of nature and the realm of art. Technai onta, or fabricated products, are human-made things created with a view to specific ends and in light of mental images as models or ideals. Along this path, art became the creation of that which exists nowhere in nature as nature. So when the Greeks of the classical and post-classical period speak of technai art and technai onta, fabricated beings, they do not in the first instance mean the fine arts, but any crafted thing at all the crafts. According to Aristotle, such objects have a finishedness around them and even an aspect of eternity. They are no longer beings of nature, but have a form or image more closely approximating eternity or perpetual presence. However, even the crafted bed still has phusis or nature within it insofar as it is made of wood. And Aristotle gives the interesting example of the wood from a bed being planted and sprouting up new roots. At this point, however, the bed is no longer a bed, but rather its material has been returned to nature. Again, everything that human beings make, which becomes an object external to them, is by art or techne. But when the Greeks wanted to underline something like our modern distinction between the crafts and the fine arts, this term techne would often, though not always, be conjoined with the term poesis, usually making in a more elevated sense. The distinction of nature and art, or as we more usually understand it, nature versus culture, is based on the fundamental distinction of phusis and techne in the works of Plato and Aristotle. Is art an imitation of nature? Is there an originary technicity or artfulness in nature itself? Beginning with the philosophy of Plato, the whole physical world of nature is in fact the product of an artist, or cosmic demiurge, who mirrors the world of sensible or perfect forms into this physical world, which is subject to dissolution and change. In a very real sense, for Plato, the whole of physical nature is a grandiose work of art, created when a primordial maker god mirrors formal properties into a chaotic or formless material stuff. Nature thus becomes, in Western philosophy, the sphere of an ongoing work of art, in which humans as well participate. And so this theme of nature versus art is a very old one, but also a recent one, and leads to all kinds of problematic projections, such as nature being more recalcitrant, passive, or feminine, and art as more shaping, active, or masculine. There may be, in the earlier understanding of nature among the archaic Greeks and other world historical peoples, conceptions of the artfulness of nature which don't depend on an imposing masculine subjectivity. The fundamental distinction in aesthetics or philosophy of art between nature and art is one of the most influential tropes in the history of our thought, Later in the course, we'll look briefly into Rudiger Safransky's biography, Goethe, Life as a Work of Art. And in addition to the four Goethean epigraphs mentioned at the beginning of this lecture, we should probably pause to read here Goethe's poem, Nature and Art, here in the David Luke translation. Nature and art, they go their separate ways, it seems. Yet all at once they find each other. Even I no longer am foe to either. Both equally attract me nowadays. Some honest toil's required. Then, phase by phase, when diligence and wit have worked together to tie us fast to art with their good tether, nature again may set our hearts ablaze. All culture is like this. The unfettered mind, the boundless spirit's mere imagination, for pure perfection's heights will strive in vain. To achieve great things, we must be self-confined. Mastery is revealed in limitation, and law alone can set us free again. For Goethe, in this poem, nature and art operate on each other through stages of reciprocal enhancement. One idea we'll find repeated again and again in the course is that the very definition of art is always twofold, involving both diligent craft and technique, hard work, as well as frequent inspirations, configured here in Goethe as returns to inspiring nature, and the beginnings of new forays into the creative imagination, but always in the self-confined limits of mastery and skill. There are the laws of presentation that are manifest in the artwork, and then there is the law of nature, alone by itself, always setting us free from the limitations of art. Having discussed some of the core ideas that we're likely to find in a philosophy of art or aesthetics class, let's return to the more general question now, what is art? And why is it a feature of some species in the natural world, such as, but not limited to, human beings? Indeed, no approach to art would be complete if it ignored the significance of art for human evolution. When and why did artfulness emerge? Are Paleolithic cave paintings, such as this image of the moving buffalo you find in the Chauvet Caves, our earliest evidence for art, strictly speaking? Or can we also understand other material archaeological evidence, such as pottery, ornate tools, or dolls, or icons with a sacred purpose as art? Is art what makes us human, or do some animals also do art in some sense, such as the bird's song, the beaver's dam, or the ant's city? As we'll see, many philosophers argue that what defines us as humans is our capacity for enhanced self-making through art. But do all our arts in fact have a biological evolutionary basis not dissimilar to the arts we find in the animal kingdom? These are big questions we can't possibly answer in an introductory video. But if the status of art in regards to the evolution of the human species, its earliest religion and civilizations interests you, consider doing a presentation on books like Dissanayake's Homo Aestheticus or Stephen Davies' The Artful Species, or on any of the numerous philosophers who have carefully examined prehistoric art and Paleolithic cave paintings, such as Georges Bataille in his Cradle of Humanity, Prehistoric Art and Culture. Let's look at a few well-known images now and ask ourselves, are these art? Are these examples of the general category art? Are these almost moving cinematographic images art? Certainly they were conceived with a high degree of artfulness. The multiple horns here, not only suggesting, but being a direct mimesis or imitation of motion, appearing, as Werner Herzog says, as a kind of cinema under the right kind of flickering light. Despite this being pretty clearly an example of what we can call art without further ado, it has also been argued that the element of sympathetic magic in ancient cave paintings, the function of these and many other images in ritual contexts, suggests a larger role for religion in works like these than for art, at least in our modern sense. What we'll discover when we study the philosophy of art and aesthetics across its long history is that art and religion only begin to be separated and treated as distinct areas of human endeavor in the modern period. And this leads to the old chicken and egg debate, what came first, religion or art? Or going even further back to Stone Age implements, what came first, tools adapted to the necessity of life, or the way of life or artfulness which produced such ornate tools? Paleolithic archaeology has uncovered a large number of statuettes of different shapes and sizes and a whole genre of these Venuses, most famously the Venus of Willendorf. Putting aside the somewhat ridiculous claim that no religious function can be claimed for these artifacts since they may merely be children's toys, it seems pretty clear that some sort of divine feminine potency is being interacted with or engaged with in artistic works like these. But again, if this is art, what distinguishes it from religion? And what are the consequences if this distinction between art and religion breaks down for the greater part of human history? Of course, looking at this famous canvas of Van Gogh, we seem to be on sure footings in saying, yeah, of course, that's art. And yet at the same time, painting prosaic tavern scenes like this was in part Van Gogh's challenge to what was considered art. And there are many who claim whenever shifts in artistic sensibilities take place, that the result is not art in the strict sense. The most famous example of this changing of the guards in regards to what counts as art in the art world is, of course, Duchamp's famous fountain, or urinal, set as the centerpiece of a great Dadaist exhibit, and involving no craft-based artistic intervention on the part of the artist at all, except placing this urinal on the podium and calling it art, indeed as the centerpiece of a large Dadaist exhibit. Here we see glimmers of the institutional definition of art. What makes art art is its being taken as art by a community comprised of creators or artists and recipients, or art critics. Also in Duchamp's famous fountain, we see a social definition of art. Art is whatever shocks and revolutionizes us into new perceptions of the world and of ourselves. On the age-old question of whether art has to be representational or mimetic, not only modern, but quite a fair bit of fresco art in the ancient world is defiantly unrepresentational, as in these images from Jackson Pollock. And on the question of whether art has to be original or even good, you can look to Andy Warhol's famous depiction of a can of Campbell's soup, which might seem to be mere advertisement, except for the nostalgia evoked in those raised on the stuff and the clear identity of Andy Warhol as an artist of rank. On the question of whether art has to be beautiful, of course the answer is no. Francis Bacon's canvases are a very good example of how ugliness is no objection to the categorization of a work as art. And although there have always been and will always be those who wish to separate the realm of art from the political, attempting to preserve the purity of art from any sorts of political ideologies, on the other hand, much great art has distinctive ideological and political functions built in. How exactly we should understand the relation between art and the political is a theme we'll explore extensively later in the course. And lastly, artists like Andy Goldsworthy and many others are famous for taking art out of the institutional context of the museum and the exhibit and back into the features of a natural landscape, very often working with and rearranging the elements that nature itself provides, and calling it art rather than nature on account of this human intervention. The two most prevalent accounts concerning the origin of art are the biological evolutionary story discussed earlier, which analyzes art in terms of universal human expression, the historical age or epoch of art from an evolutionary or even geological perspective, and the intrinsic pleasure or value that creatures like us find in works of art. Over and against this story, we might also speak of the cultural invention of art. That is, the distinction of crafts more rooted in evolutionary biology and human culture per se, which is extra-biological, and when we ask what art means in the context of, there are many contexts which we must discuss in a course like this, such as museum art versus tourist art versus popular art versus ancient art, which by and large was coextensive with the religious domain. These four domains in particular in the modern to contemporary period seem to be distinctive art worlds. The art of Burning Man having a completely different character and social context than, say, museum art. The meaning, character, and function of art indeed changes significantly depending on the context of its production and consumption. As to definitions of art itself, the two most common in contemporary discourses on aesthetics are the honorific definition and classificatory definitions. Honorific definitions tend to be more open-ended. What do you honor or define as art? You might participate in an honorific definition of art and also be a conscious or unconscious member of various schools of the definition of art. Art is art if it meets certain necessary and sufficient conditions, according to, say, realism, expressionism, or formalism. The honorific definition of art is more open-ended and even intuitional. Here we apply the term art to what people believe is good or even great art, and we explain why. Classificatory definitions of the nature of art are more specific. It's art if it functions as art, that is, if it's called art in any social context. For example, if you want to know what art is, go to the museum and see what's on display. art is what art worlds say is art, this definition of art tending to be more institutional. Although what counts as an art world in this context is, of course, up for debate. For 19th and 20th century definitions of art, which are often discussed in the discourse of aesthetics, include realism, expressionism, formalism, and postmodernism. For example, on some definitions of realism, art should reflect realities that are true as well as beautiful. According to expressionism, art should express sublime and disturbing experiences, regardless of truth. For formalism, neither truth nor expression matter nearly as much for art as exquisite formation or technical perfection. And more common these days, for postmodern pluralists, defining art is much less important than experiencing its unsettling uncertainties. This is a good example of the torturous turns of phrase common in analytic philosophical attempts to define art. A definition of art should indicate what all and only art has in common and in virtue of which it is art. In other words, a definition should identify the elements that all art must have, such that anything possessing them thereby is art. This seems to be a tall order, much in contrast with Andy Warhol's quip that art is anything you can get away with. For example, the above image on the right here is unequivocally called art, on account of its mosaic context, whereas the image below it sometimes considered vandalism. Definitely art, but for some, the artist didn't get away with it. Implicit in definitions of art are the philosophical concepts of necessary versus sufficient conditions. Philosophers in the class are probably very familiar with this from other philosophy courses you've taken. When it comes to defining something as something, a work of art as art, you can call something art only if it fulfills all of the necessary conditions. A sufficient condition, however, is a condition that, when satisfied, guarantees that what satisfies it is an X, is art. A definition of art should identify those necessary conditions or set of necessary conditions that is sufficient for something being called art. This is yet a separate issue than the extension of the concept X, which is the class of things falling under it. And here we generally find that whatever we define as the necessary and sufficient conditions for the concept art, there will always be outliers and limit cases which problematize our definitions. In other words, we might agree on the nature of the concept of art itself without always agreeing on the extension of the concept of art in the world. These types of conceptual and extensional difficulties has led many philosophers to argue against any possible definition of art, promoting instead a more open understanding according to which no conditions are necessary for something being called art. And this is because art's own creative, rebellious, or transgressive nature prevents any strict definition. Defining art is indeed a possible cognitive exercise, but not, according to the open definition, a very useful or revealing one. Three analytic definitions of art that are all quite prominent include aesthetic functionalism, the institutional theory, and historicism. For the aesthetic functionalist, something is an artwork if it is intended to provide the person who contemplates it for its own sake with an aesthetic experience of a significant enough magnitude on the basis of an appreciation of purely aesthetic features. A work of art is art if it performs this function sufficiently. In contrast, the institutional theory states that an artwork is an artifact of a kind created by artists to be presented to an art world public, already discussed earlier under the classificatory definition. And according to the historicists, something is art if it stands in an appropriate historical relation to its artistic predecessors. This would not mean slavishly imitating history, but rather inheriting and transforming in meaningful ways within the practice and the discourse of art. For the purposes of this course, we're going to avoid a lot of the nuanced debates in analytic philosophy regarding the definition and extension of the concept art. Proceed rather with what is probably the simplest definition of art. Art, or what the Greeks called techne or poesis, is just making, creating something new which transcends its materials and might or might not have various functions in the social world or beyond. According to Joyce Carol Oates, any form of art is a species of exploration and transgression. By its very nature, art is a transgressive act, and the more original and unsettling their art, the more devastating the social reaction or punishment. Next up, we have to ask what the differences are between aesthetics and the philosophy of art on the one hand, and art criticism on the other. Are these terms synonymous or not? Why or why not? Aesthetics can be most broadly defined as a philosophy of sense perception, more specifically, as a thinking about what appears or manifests in the work of art. Aesthetics is a more circumscribed and modern term in comparison to the broader philosophy of art, the title of our course. but even within the philosophy of art, we could have different understandings of what constitutes doing philosophy of art and what the domain of inquiry of philosophy of art entails. Should philosophy of art be narrowly focused on definitions and categorical schema or classifications for artistic phenomena, what we might call the splitter approach? Should philosophy of art be about the larger or big questions raised by works of art and the historical tradition of the arts, letting the work of art itself open up the world in which philosophical thinking takes place and affirming a fundamental relationship between philosophical thought and artistic creativity and technique? This might be the more broad-minded or lumper approach to the domain of the philosophy of art. And lastly, should the philosophy of art be more concerned with Erfahrung or Erlebnis? These are two German terms which roughly mean lived experience, but the distinction between them is quite significant for the history of aesthetics and philosophy of art. Erfahrung having to do more with the deep fathoming of works of art and their meaningfulness or significance as an exploratory process between human beings and the world. For the Erfahrung definition of philosophy of art, philosophy is searching for the world disclosed in the work of art, so as to participate in the artistic world opened up by art as domains always oriented by the future. In contrast, we also busy ourselves with works of art from the point of view of mere lived experience. Have you been to such and such exhibit and seen the Mona Lisa, for example? Is the business of art to provide us with lived experiences of art and a more objective kind of experience, with setting us on the path to art, perhaps even towards the feast of thinking and of world opened up in the artwork? Lastly, aesthetics and philosophy of art are together often distinguished from art criticism, which is generally the domain of art historians, but can also refer to cultural critics in any given period. The artistic critic educates and trains the directions of perception, aesthetic education, where the goal of aesthetic criticism is often a more enlightened cherishing of the nature of particular artworks. This is a quite different goal than philosophy of art, which may not always seek the end of a higher enlightened cherishing, but rather attempts to understand the very being of the work of art and its relation to other philosophical and social domains. Art criticism can also be distinguished from aesthetics in that aesthetics tends to concern more our experience of art and its conditions of possibility and development, rather than the direct training and education of aesthetic perception. These lines are far from clear and distinct, and as we'll see, aesthetics, philosophy of art, and art criticism tend to intertwine in the philosophical discourse about art to a large extent. A final key term that's important to get clear at the beginning is the term mimesis, or imitation. The defining study of the concept of mimesis across the history of philosophy of art is certainly Eric Auerbach's Mimesis, the representation of reality in Western literature. As discussed earlier, in the Greek, mimesis means something like our modern English imitation, where ancient philosophers considered, kind of strangely to our ears, poetry, dance, painting, and sculpture all as imitative arts. This idea of imitative art, although it produces the representational theory of art, means something quite a bit more gestural and embodied than mere representation. In any case, it's common to point out, somewhat reductively, that for ancient philosophers of art, a painting or sculpture is good insofar as it imitates or represents its subject well, usually involving a high ethical or moral value. The poet likewise holds a mirror to nature, to the gods, and to the great events of human history in their verse. The idea that art should conform to and reproduce its models is, as we'll see, one of the main reasons why we got stuck with the representational theory of art. Let's turn now to a more in-depth introduction on the status of the concept of the beautiful in ancient Greece and of the relation of the various arts. Again, beauty in Greek kalon, in Latin pulchrum, was not really distinguished in the classical and Roman worlds from ethics, ethos, or way of life. When Plotinus, the great Neoplatonic philosopher, speaks of the beautiful and the good, he has in view specific metaphysical and ethical issues. They have a distinctively aesthetic dimension, but that aesthetic dimension is not separated out. Regarding the division of the arts among the Greeks, we could say that the most important and highest art is that of poetry or Mousike. Poetry is the most elevated art form because, unlike the mere crafts which require technical skill, the excellent poet is thought to be inspired by the divine forces of the muses, literal goddesses who are the daughters of Zeus and Mnemosune, or memory. In Greek, the poet is an aiolos, or inspired singer. In Latin, the term is vates. And the depiction of aiodoi goes all the way back to the beginning of Greek literature in Homer's The Iliad and the Odyssey. Such poet performers in the houses of wealthy patrons and kings come to be called rhapsodists. That is, those who perform and bring the poetry of Homer or others to life. The Celtic English word is bard. Since these rhapsodists did not invent new verses of their own, but rather perform traditional material, while at the same time ad-libbing and explaining it, they can be understood a bit on the model of the modern DJ. In the religious universe of the ancient Greeks, poets are most revered among the technicians because they are divinely inspired, that is, closest to the gods among mortals, except that is for the heroes and the kings that they sing. As we'll see, Plato is suspicious of the high esteem in which poets and poetry are held. While Aristotle seems less concerned to regulate the poets than to analyze their works and let them go their merry way. Not strictly distinguishable from poetry, but more distinguished in our minds as moderns, the second highest class of artisans in the ancient Greek world were the musicians. However, poetry and music were one and the same art form from the Greek term Mousike, which means literally deriving from the muses. Mousike included musical education, poetry, storytelling, singing and dance, and the better part of how mythology was communicated. Only in the 18th and 19th century, from the German Romantics through the birth of classical philology and Nietzsche into the 20th century, do we find scholars who specialize in ancient Greek aesthetics carefully studying Greek musike. Most of what we have is the poetry, for example, the Odes of Pindar, or Homeric verse. But this poetry is highly metrically or musically structured, involving the alternation of long and short vowels. And in some cases, based on the texts themselves and a few surviving fragments of Greek music, the competent scholar can infer something of the character of the music and even the dance steps that might have attended certain moments in the poetic recitation. According to the 20th century classic scholar Thrasybulos Georgiadis, ancient Greek poetic language was structured so musically that music and dance tended to follow the words, the mythos or logos being primary, whereas in the history of modern poetry, beginning even with Shakespeare, the reverse holds true, the poetry tending to follow and be set to music. Even during the classical Greek period, however, sometimes instrumental music was separated from poetry. And this is one of the things that raises Plato's ire in his critique of the tragic poets and newfangled musical styles. In other cases, like in Pythagorean cult communities, the study of mathematics led to a mathematical analysis of musical intervals and the creation of novel scales and new musical forms. Frustratingly, very little of ancient Greek music survives, and most of what we know is reconstructed, predominantly from the dialogues of Plato and the treatises of those of Aristotle's students who were concerned with music, such as Aristoxenus. For those interested in how ancient Greek music sounded, the tomb epitaph, the Song of Psychilos, on which is engraved both the words and the music, is particularly beautiful. And I've included in the modules this week two YouTube playlists of ancient Greek music reperformed for you to explore. The modes or styles of ancient Greek music were defined by the scales to which the lyre was set. For example, Ionian music being set to a major scale and Aeolian to a minor scale, where the various scales were understood in terms of the doctrine of ethos. That is the felt mood or different feeling that each mode evoked. Music was not only a human affair, but referred back to the realm of the divine and the gods. The god Hermes being the inventor of the lyre, and the god Apollo receiving it from Hermes, and the retinue of the god Dionysus being associated with the music of the flute. Being the inventors of music, the Greek gods took an interest in great musical performers in the human sphere, and were often challenged to musical competitions by mortal performers who would, of course, almost invariably lose and suffer the consequence for their hubris in regards to the gods. In addition to the musical scales or modes, there were a large variety of song genres. That is, different types of songs for a wide variety of occasions. Songs of nomos would celebrate the customs of a particular group of peoples. Hymns or hymnos were songs in honor of the gods, evoking their ritual presence. The paean is a cultic song in honor of the god Apollo, and the dithyram a cultic song in honor of the god Dionysus. The variety of song genres is quite extensive. Folk laments, songs to Adonis, dance songs, satirical songs. Elegions, or songs honoring the dead, from which we get the modern English elegy. Threnos songs, or laments for the dead. And encomions, or feast day songs in praise for the living. Drinking songs, wedding songs, phallic songs, work songs. The world of ancient Greek music and song, or musike, was very vast, and likely exceedingly beautiful. Poetry slash music was again the chief art of the Greeks in our modern sense of what an art is. And it definitely outranked associated fine arts, such as painting, sculpture, or architecture. Practitioners of these arts could achieve a good degree of fame and notoriety in exceptional instances, but were generally considered lower craftsmen, part of the bonastic crafts, and subject to a great deal of unenviable labor for little pay. We tend to see Greek vase painting as a symbol of high culture, and imagine that Greek vase painters were highly respected. The majority of potters and vase painters were at the lowest rung of the crafts or arts in the ancient Greek system of artistic value. If an art was more associated with manual human labor and mere skill, as opposed to festive or divine inspiration, it tended to be undervalued in comparison to poetry, and exceptions existed only for the most skilled of painters, sculptors, or architects. Importantly for the history of modern aesthetics, and its Eurocentric emphasis on the greatness and beauty of Greek art, the ugly truth and the ugly history here is quite instructive. While modern Europeans since the Renaissance admired above all the spare and simple beauty of the Greek statue, associating its whiteness with purity, and even the holiness of pure religious sentiment. In fact, ancient Greek statues were invariably painted, and often garishly so. You can link here to some of the work by pigment scientists on what these ancient Greek statues actually looked like. And alas, if the reconstruction of the colors and the surviving microscopic pigments on the statue can be trusted, some of these works might have looked more like what we're accustomed to find in Las Vegas than the refined lily-white purity that we have been indoctrinated to believe is the essence of Greek art. So having set all this up, what we're going to do now is look to the philosopher Plato on art. And the first document of what we could consider artistic or literary criticism in the Western canon, Plato's Ion. Indeed, in Plato, art becomes the subject of extensive critical philosophical investigation for the first time. The standard or easy boring view is that Plato thought little of artists and wanted them to exist only insofar as they could be conformed to reason and philosophy. However, a more subtle and observant take would reveal how Plato himself began with a desire to be an artist, a tragic poet. And after meeting Socrates, tore up his youthful attempts at tragedies in order to devote himself to philosophy, thereby recreating philosophy in a new dramatic art form, the form of the dialogue. Plato as philosopher versus Plato as artist, the artist of dialogues, is a very significant point in that it upsets from the get-go any oversimplistic distinction of philosophy and art. Let's turn now to Plato's dialogue, The Ion. This dialogue finds the historical Socrates fulfilling his mission from the Delphic Oracle. The oracle had been asked, who is the wisest person, and answered that it is Socrates, followed by the tragic poet Euripides. How could I, Socrates, be wiser than Euripides, who is so popular, Socrates asks. And part of his mission becomes to seek out experts in every particular field of endeavor to see what types of knowledge that they possess and whether or not it exceeds his own or is superior in any way. The Ion thus stages a conversation that the historical Socrates likely really had with a great rock star or poet rhapsodist, and what it dramatizes is the status of poetry, both in regards to the gods and with respect to philosophical self-knowledge. We're not sure if Socrates in fact held the views expressed by him in the dialogue, but it does seem to be part of his divine mission from Apollo to question experts in their field of knowledge and invariably to find them wanting. So let's get further into the dialogue itself. The setup of the dialogue is that Ion is a sort of rock star rhapsodist from the stylish city of Ephesus, whose biggest claims to fame is that it's the home of the Artemisian, great temple of the goddess Artemis, and a couple centuries earlier of the philosopher Heraclitus. Ion is just back from the healing city of Epidaurus, not too far from Athens, where he won the first prize at the Festival of the Asclepian, a festival devoted to the son of Apollo, Asclepius, the god of healing and medicine. Now, Ion is something of a high-profile DJ, always beautifully dressed and highly acclaimed for his skill, a traveler of the Greek festival circuit. He's very successful, although like many DJs, his ego seems a little ginormous. Socrates teases him quite a lot, mostly respectfully, and gets very interested in the question of whether Ion knows anything about the records he spins, or if he's just good at grooving to Homer, and if so, why does he only like Homer? There is a neat condensed theatrical reading of parts of the Ion on YouTube by two theater actors, which I recommend. The main thrust of Socrates' questioning to Ion is to ask whether the art of rhapsody, or the technai of the rhapsodist as a memorizer and reciter of verses, is in fact a technique at all. Is there any art or artfulness to what Ion does, or is it not rather that he is under the influence of inspiration from the gods? At first, Ion admits readily that although the rhapsodist ends up singing of many highly technical things, such as medicine, arithmetic, charioteering, there are, he also admits, experts in those fields whose technical know-how exceeds his own. But he also seems to think there are certain arts, such as the art of being a military general, for which the rhapsode is equally or better qualified. Why would this be so? Well, simply because the rhapsodist and the general are both experts at commanding the passions of men. Having broken down the various arts that the rhapsode sings of and distinguished them in terms of expertise from actual artists in those fields, Socrates goes on to wonder whether Ion perhaps has knowledge of the art of poetry as a whole, or just a particular poet, Homer. And he discovers, as Ion admits, that he dozes off, falls to sleep whenever any other poet is discussed, that Ion is in fact relatively ignorant of the genre of poetry as a whole. This seems to come down to the point that Ion is not really an art critic either, but rather an appreciator and aficionado of Homer. At this point, Socrates ventures an alternative explanation for why Ion speaks so eloquently about Homer. He has no knowledge, but is divinely possessed. We get Socrates' most beautiful speech in the dialogue, part ironically and part sincerely praising poets as winged and holy things, whose gifts from the gods make them closely akin to a divine form of madness. Quote, "It's a divine power that moves you, as a magnetic stone moves iron rings. In the same way, the muse makes some people inspired herself, and through those who are inspired, a chain of enthusiasts is suspended. The poet Oriodos is the one who gathers songs at honey-flowing springs from glades and gardens of the muses. And they bear their songs to us as bees carry honey, flying like bees. For what the people say is true. The poet is an airy thing, winged and holy, and he is not able to make poetry until he becomes inspired and goes out of his mind." As evidence for his claim, Socrates points to the one-hit wonders song of the poet Tinicus, basically saying all his other poems are crap, but he wrote this one really fine thing that everyone remembers him for. And that song was an invention of the muses. Antiochus himself admits this. But where does this leave Ion? At this point, Socrates deepens his discussion of the divine sources of poetry in terms of the many muses, whose powers work by inspiration, not art. That is not techne or know-how, a form of knowledge. One muse sings dithyrambs, that is Dionysian ecstasies, another epics, the Homeric stories, yet another encomnia, feast day songs, and yet another iambics or paeans, songs to Apollo. True poetry, or in general, all higher art is an invention of the muses. And here Socrates lays out a schema for understanding the levels of inspiration from a muse, which we'll see further developed next week in Plato's Republic, Book 10. True poets do not speak for themselves subjectively, but are representatives or interpreters, hermeneutes of the gods, through the medium of possession by a muse. And so once removed from the source of knowledge, rhapsodes in turn are mere interpreters of interpreters, and so twice removed from the source of knowledge. And spectators form the third and final link in the Heraclean chain, but all are in some sense suspended from and betrothed to the god. And thus we hear quite beautifully that there is an enormous chain of choral dancers and dance teachers and assistant teachers hanging off to the sides of the rings that are suspended from the muses. One poet is attached to one muse, another to another, and we say he is possessed, and that's near enough, for he is held. At first, Ion is positively enthusiastic about Socrates' explanation, but then, after hearing it twice, he objects. "Hey, wait a minute, Socrates. I thought I liked what you were saying, but there's a problem. If you heard me recite and then talk about Homeric epic, you wouldn't be able to sustain this explanation, that I'm simply mad, crazed, or inspired. I'm obviously thinking and knowing in some sense when I interpret the poems of Homer." And here we can agree that Ion is correct. For there is indeed an art of memorizing that the rhapsode must deploy, as well as an art of pathos or affect in performance. And these arts are clearly, in Ion's case, not wholly unconscious or involuntary. At this point, Socrates attempts to deepen his argument, but doesn't add much, and Ion does his own argument a disservice by again claiming that the good rhapsode is also by definition a good general. By the end of the Ion, neither Socrates' nor Ion's argument is wholly convincing. The argument as a whole hinges on the distinction of techne as artistry or know-how from mania, that is, divine possession or enthusiasmos. And both Socrates and Ion have good points. Socrates' point is that Ion should be praised for his role as a link in the chain of inspiration from the muses and the gods. Socrates wants to think of poets and rhapsodes in a lovelier way as ones more divine. Ion, however, is not convinced. He acknowledges that he is not himself a poet and doesn't know the art of poetry as a whole, but evidently for him, he knows something. As anyone who has ever tried to write a poem or create a work of art understands, there really is a distinction between technique and inspiration, or techne and mania in the Greek here, when attempting to make art. And to be a good artist, one indeed needs both diligent craft and frequent inspiration. Furthermore, some arts are more technique-based, such as sculpture or architecture, while others may be more inspiration-based, like improvising on a guitar. However, all require a balance between vision, inspiration, and technique. We can also agree with Socrates that as a vessel or magnet in the chain of inspiration from the muses, the rhapsode does seem to be more on the side of inspiration than artistry, despite the fact that there is a mnemonic technique and an art of pathos or ability to whip up a crowd into a passion of ecstasy, only in the next moment to bring them to bouts of weeping. Ion notes that his ability to make an audience laugh when they are crying and cry when they are laughing must involve some level of skill or artistry on his part. Unsatisfyingly, the dialogue concludes with an ultimatum and something of a false dilemma. Which do you prefer, Ion, to be thought dishonest or inspired? And of course, Ion chooses inspiration as by far the nobler. And in this way, the intrinsic complications of the dialogue are resolved heavy-handedly in favor of the argument of Socrates. We'll see how these issues play out in more detail in our deeper study of Plato on the philosophy of art and aesthetics next week. I hope you've enjoyed this overview lecture on the history of the philosophy of art and aesthetics. See you next week.